Well, it's been 4 long weeks, but we're finally here. After an entire month of looking back at the best films of the year, we're finally ready to give you our top 10 movies of 2017.
Aaron, all your reviews just got pegged for not being advertiser friendly.
Don't! Well, it's been 5 long weeks, but we're finally almost here again. After a whole month and a week of looking back at the best films from last year, it's finally time to give you my top 10 movies of 2017.
Aaron, a third-party company that has nothing to do with your video is claiming they own it and they're taking all your money.
Don't! Here are our top 10 movies.
Aaron!
Honorable mentions! Wonder Woman. I couldn't put this on the list because the last third of this film just loses its freaking mind. But up until then, it's a damn good superhero movie that understands the character, understood her message, was shot wonderfully, and despite all the problems I did have with it, I will always look back on and remember the No Man's Land scene, which will be one of the best superhero moments ever captured on film. It. I love horror films, and this is one of the only that I'd ever describe as a crowd pleaser. Being in the audience watching this movie was probably the best theater going experience I've ever had with a horror film, and while it did freak me out, it still kept me excited for more. Mother. And now the complete opposite of It. This is probably the worst theater going experience I've had all year. This is a truly unpleasant film to sit through. But that's kind of the point. That's how you're supposed to feel, so mission accomplished? However, the reason it gets an honorable mention is because I spent this whole film trying to figure out what was going on, then about 5 minutes before it ended, I finally got it, and after that, I started to appreciate it. Then, I kept thinking about and realizing how deep that metaphor in this film went. And the more I thought about it, and the more I went back and started reinterpreting scenes, I began to appreciate it, and then eventually I was full on loving it. I never want to watch this movie again, but in the end, I was really blown away by it. Brigsby Bear and Colossal. I'm going to put these two together because both of them are on here for the same reason. It felt so good to have a movie this original this year. If you ever hear someone say that there's no more original ideas out there, show them Brigsby Bear or Colossal. Both of these are unlike anything I've ever watched, and honestly, the less you know about them, the better. Don't even watch the trailers for them, and go into them completely cold. Star Wars: The Last Jedi. Yes, there are some problems with it, and it's not a perfect movie, but it's got some perfect moments to it. There are some of my favorite moments from any Star Wars film in this one, and after the first movie where Disney treated Star Wars like it was an action figure that they had to keep in the box, this felt like them finally saying, you know what? Let's open this sucker up and actually play with it. It established some new directions for this franchise, and I love seeing that. I am really excited to see what they're going to do with everything that they built up in this film. Big Sick. In a world where so many romantic comedies feel the same, this one was very different. It's a romantic comedy where one of the two people involved is in a coma, and the other one has to not only deal with her parents who are screwed up in their own way, but also has to work through his own issues with his past, his culture, and his place in the world. It's a great love story, but also a great study of these characters. Blade Runner 2049. This got so close to being on this list, and I'm pretty sure that if I went back a week from now and remade this list, it would probably be up there. The cinematography is some of the best all year. It continues on the story from the original in a very unexpected direction that is kind of perfect, and honestly, I thought it did an even better job of raising questions about the soul, about what it means to be a human, than the first film did. And now, on to number 10. Logan Lucky. This is easily my favorite Steven Soderbergh film, and it was a huge surprise to me. I heard this was going to be a heist film starring Channing Tatum and Daniel Craig robbing a NASCAR event. Okay, sounds like it could be fun, but I had no idea it was going to be this good. This isn't just a great comedy, it has my favorite joke of any film this year. I was rolling while watching this film, And it's also just so smart and clever. A good heist film relies on a crazy cast of characters pulling off nearly impossible feats, and this one nailed it in ways that was constantly surprising me. Number 9, Three Billboards Outside Ebbing, Missouri. One thing I love in a story is just the adventures of screwed up people, and no movie did that better this year than Three Billboards. This whole movie is just good people doing really bad things, and really bad people doing good things, and really bad things, and stuff in between. This starts off following a mother who is looking for answers from the cops, and you are prepared to root for her and boo the cops. But then the sheriff shows some sides to him that makes you think, oh, I guess he's not that bad. And then the mom does some stuff that actually is pretty messed up. Or there's a character in here who is just there for comedic relief until he does one of the most horrifying, unforgivable things I've seen all year. And it's like the movie turned to you and went, oh, you thought you knew what direction we were going with him? Think again. This whole movie is just getting amazing actors to play characters who get new layers added to them every couple of scenes, and every new turn this story took had me holding on for the next. Number 8, Coco. You guys know me, I love movies with heart, and this one probably had more than any other film this year. Not only is it such a touching story about family that I was struggling to hold back the tears by the end of it, but it's also got the most incredible sense of style I've seen all year. This world looks amazing. Every time that they went into another part of the Land of the Dead, I was blown away all over again. And the cast is fantastic. In order to sell a story about heart, you really have to make me believe that everyone cares about each other. And this movie succeeded. Number 7, Thor Ragnarok. I know everyone out there is going to say, you love this just because you're a Marvel fanboy. You loved it just because it was funny. Hey, I'll admit, I do love the Marvel Cinematic Universe. And yes, this movie is hilarious. In fact, one of my few complaints about the movie is that maybe it was too funny. But the reason it gets on the list is because it also shows some solid character development for Thor, has one of my favorite villains in any Marvel film, a gorgeous art style to it, but the thing that really bumps it up this high on the list is because about halfway through the movie, they stop, turn to the audience and say, oh, you thought this was just a fun space adventure? Guess what? Here's what it's actually about. And honestly, I was stunned that it decided to go there. And the way that led into the end of this film, and the big message of, hey, sometimes a civilization built on the sins of its past can't escape those sins. Sometimes you just have to tear it all down. You have to just let something like that collapse. And you know something? That's not always a bad thing. That is a shockingly bold message for a superhero movie. Everybody's always criticizing Disney for not doing anything really interesting with these characters or for not being very bold with these characters, but holy cow, I can't think of the last film that had a message like that, and this is a Thor Hulk team-up movie. Number 6, Detroit. This is a hard one to be passionate about because it's not a funny, heartwarming movie. It's not something you want to run out and tell other people they have to see. This is just a really upsetting and heartbreaking movie to watch. But I've often said the point of art isn't to make you happy, it's not to make you laugh, it's to make you feel something. And this movie made me feel depression, torment, and anger. Truckloads of anger. But that's what it was supposed to make you feel. And this movie is made by Kathryn Bigelow, who in my opinion can build tension better than almost any other director out there, and by the 13-minute mark, she had already made my mouth drop open and left me speechless. That's gotta be a record. Number 5, Spider-Man Homecoming. Alright, if there is any film on this list that you can call me a fanboy for, it's this one. I'll gladly admit that. Spider-Man is my favorite hero out there, and I'm not going to lie, I started to tear up when the Marvel Cinematic Universe logo came up and they were playing the Spider-Man theme song over it, because my boy was finally home. He was finally back where he belonged. But even beyond that, this is a great coming-of-age story. A great story about learning who you are and where you're meant to be. but also it was a huge breath of fresh air. People applauded Civil War because it addressed that Marvel had been blowing up too much stuff in their films. This movie addressed, yeah, and our heroes are way too big. We need some smaller guys. Every single Marvel hero was the giant I will save the whole world style hero, and this was a movie about Spider-Man saying, hey, I want to be the big save the whole world hero, and Iron Man straight up told him, no, we have enough of those. Be the smaller guy. But also, this was just the film Spider-Man needed. So many people have criticized Spider-Man because his other films made him too sad, too mopey, too depressed, and there's a reason for that. All the other movies had to focus on the major points of Spidey's life, and those major points are really depressing. People have criticized this film for not being big enough, for being too basic, but yeah, that's kind of what we needed. We needed a Spider-Man film that just said, it's not always doom and gloom. Sometimes Spidey just has an adventure where it isn't all crap and his life isn't destroyed. This was the film that showed people who only knew Spidey from the movies, this is what his day-to-day life is. This is Spidey the other 90% of the time that you haven't seen, and that's kind of what the movies needed at this point. Number 4, Your Name. Now, let me go ahead and address the elephant in the room. Someone is going to come into the comments and say, oh, that movie didn't come out in 2017, it came out in 2016. Yes, the original Japanese version did come out in 2016, and it received a limited release in the States that year. But the dub came out in 2017, and it actually received a wide release in theaters that year. And that's the one that I saw, so that's the one that I'm counting. But even if it didn't come out at all in 2017, I saw it for the first time in 2017, and darn it, I really want to talk about it. This is a love story about two people who have never met, from two different towns, who keep swapping bodies. They don't know why it's happening, they don't know when it's going to happen, just sometimes they wake up in each other's bodies, so they decide to make the best of it, and as they go along, they start to get to know more about each other through the people in their lives, through interacting with everyone else around them, but also through the notes that they leave each other. Now again, this is a very odd situation right off the bat, which makes it one of the most original love stories I've ever seen, but about halfway through this movie, there is a twist that wrecked me. By the end of this movie, I was fighting back tears for the next 6 hours. Yeah, bring some tissues for this one, everybody. Number 3, Baby Driver. I've heard people complain about how the story of this film isn't very original, and yes, it's a basic story. About a heist and a criminal who's doing one last job, but he keeps getting pulled back into this life. You're right, this is a very basic story that we've seen 1,000 times over. You can take a story I've seen 1,000 times before as long as you shoot it and tell it in a new way, in a unique way, in a way that can't be reproduced and gets you fully invested. That's fine. If you can do all that, then I don't care if you have a basic story. And this movie does all that and more. Think of this movie as one long music video. Hell, this might as well count as a musical because there is a soundtrack playing at all times throughout this film, which does play into the plot. It's not just there, it actually is part of the story. But everything in this film happens to that soundtrack. From every twist and turn the getaway car takes, which by the way, the car chase scenes in this film are some of the best I've ever witnessed, all the way down to how someone taps a glass or enters a room. This is a film that is worth experiencing more than once because the first time that you see it, you'll be blown away by what they're doing, so much so that you won't even notice how far they went with it. Number 2, Logan. I've mentioned on this list a lot of things that I love in films, but one of my favorite types of stories is the old guy being called back into action one last time, and this year we saw that with Wolverine, and it's one of the best examples of this type of story I can think of. This movie took all the big superhero-y action of the X-Men films that we've been witnessing for the past 17 years, and it said, yeah, this is what happens when all of that went away, when it all died off. And no one was left. And it's not Logan fighting giant sentinels or Apocalypse or even Magneto, it's Wolverine fighting himself. having to find it in himself to be a hero one last time after he's lost everything. And that's really sold by Jackman giving what is quite possibly the best performance of his life. And what I find so incredible about this movie is that from the outside, it doesn't look like a superhero movie. It looks like a Western, but it still embraces all the stuff of the previous films. It talks about them in a way that really makes you understand, wow, we've really been through a lot. This was Jackman's send-off to Wolverine, and it made the audience realize, holy cow, I've been following this guy's adventures for almost 2 decades. That's kind of a big deal, and now I have to say goodbye. And at the very end of this movie, after going on such a huge final adventure, there is one small, tiny thing that many people I've spoken to didn't even notice. But when I saw it, I just started bawling. And the fact that such a small detail could serve as the perfect period mark to this entire franchise is beautiful. And lastly, at number one, my favorite film of 2017, Get Out. Even though this movie came out in February, I didn't get to see it until October, so I had almost an entire year of buildup and hype going into this film, and it still managed to surpass all that. This is the smartest horror film I have seen in decades. Not just with the message, which isn't just important, but goes so deep that they teach college courses on this film, and yeah, I totally see how. You could spend a whole day diagnosing single lines in this movie, but it's also smart just with how it's shot. I watched tons of horror movies, but about 5 minutes into this film, I thought, this doesn't feel like other horror movies. I wonder why. And then it hit me, oh, this is shot like a good film. Like someone is actually trying. And this movie had a small budget, and you would never guess because of just how well they filmed it. The shots of going into the sunken place is one of the most chilling things I've ever seen. And the story itself is just so brilliant. This is a movie where you will gasp when twists are revealed, but if you go back and watch it again, you'll be impressed with how well they set it up. This is a movie where when you watch it the second time, almost every single line has a second meaning. That's an incredible feat of filmmaking. Get Out was the scariest film of the year, the best written film of the year, the smartest film of the year, and I am so glad that it is getting the recognition it deserves. Thank you guys very much for tuning in for the finale to our month-long look back at all the films from 2017. Starting next week, we are finally going to start looking at all the new movies coming out in 2018, and I'm sure that it's going to be another amazing year of great... Oh, God. Well, I feel like now would be a good time to remind everyone that in just a few days, we're also going to be counting down the worst films of 2017. So if you want to see that, then make sure that you click on that subscribe button. And if you want to see us talk in much more detail about every single one of these movies, we did the Quest for the Best all month long, in which we looked back at many of the films that people call the best of the year, and we just gave you our thoughts immediately after watching them, and you can click on the playlist that's popping up right there for that. Or let me know in the comments down below or on Twitter at twitter.com/ProfessorThorgy, what were your favorite films of 2017? Thanks for tuning in, everyone. Come back next time.